Good morning. Can you hear me? Hello, guys. Can you hear me? Okay, yeah, we still have a few minutes. So let me enable my 5G cellular hotspot. Okay, so I hope I can provide a stable lecture. Okay, any questions before we start? Everything is okay? Hello? So I'm working on the network switch. Where is my network? Not find it. Somehow cannot find it. Okay, but anyway, I put my cellular network as a backup. Okay. Yeah, no, it can't. Yeah, maybe let me connect to my cellular network. Hello guys, can you hear me? I want to confirm this because I switch to another network. Okay, thank you guys. Okay, I think we can start now. Okay, yeah. So yesterday, actually, we talked about conditional variable, right? So can you guys see my screen, which is related to the definition and the routine for the conditional variable? Okay, yeah. So basically, the idea is very simple. In a lot of cases, we need to check the condition, then continue under multiple thread environment. In pthread library, we provide a condition variable. The function is at wait. Wait means you can wait for a particular conditional variable, which is defined like this. Okay. Then associated with each conditional variable, we also have a mutex. Basically, we want to, when we access this conditional variable, we want to make sure this is a mutual exclusive. Then after a particular application has been finished, the condition has been changed, then we can use this function signal to send the signal for all thread waiting for this condition to be changed. Okay, so basically waiting for this condition, right? Okay, then this is a whole definition, right? Basically we have a conditional variable, how to declare, then how to wait, then how to signal for waking up one thread. Then we talk about a typical application, parents waiting for the trial to be finished. Okay, so we also talk about some rule. For example, when we use a conditional variable, always use like this way. So if we want to wait, then first use a mutex to protect, make this become a critical session. Then inside, when we wait for the condition, always use while. Okay, that's it. Okay, then of course, after we finish, after we need to change the condition, then change our state variable. Okay, then send a signal. Okay, this is from the how we signal condition and state have been changed. Okay, then the other side is for the thread that wait for a particular condition variable like this. Okay, use while, and whenever we want to do this, either for wait or for signal, then make sure we use lock to lock this part. Okay, make it become a critical session. So then we talk about a very classical question, producer and consumer. So the idea is that we have a producer that can produce data. Particularly, we will put this data into a buffer. Okay. Yesterday's lecture, we talked about this buffer is an integer buffer, only can contain one integer. Okay. For consumer, that can grab data from this integer buffer, a variable integer buffer. Okay. So consume some way. For example, it's just return this, store this value into a temporal variable. Then change the buffer state. Buffer state, either buffer is full or empty. This can be applied into many situations. For example, HTTP server. Maybe we have one thread is a producer. After we get a user request, and then just put this into a queue. Then a consumer directly get those requests from the queue, producer and consumer. So one condition we need to check is for producer, we have to make sure the buffer is not full. Okay. If a buffer is full, then we cannot generate data because we will overlap the data, previous data. Previous data, if it's not consumed, we cannot continuously generate data. We have to wait until the data in buffer are consumed, then we can continue, right? Similarly, for the consumer, we need to make sure the buffer is not empty. If a buffer is empty, then consumer should wait because no data to consume. So basically, we have producer, consumer, then we have a state. State relate to this buffer, right? Either is full or is empty. Okay, because we only have very simple case. An integer buffer, either is full, is empty, right? So we talk about how to represent our buffer, right? So you can see that we have a global buffer here, integer buffer, then our state is count. Basically, zero means empty, one means is full, okay? Operations, specific operation, put the data, get data can be read like this way, right? If the buffer is empty, then we just generate the data, then change the state. If a buffer is full, then consumer can get data, then change the state. Okay, perfect. So producer, in order to implement, we talk about the first generation, but yesterday we talked about when we use a conditional variable, we can do like this way, right? So if we don't use well, what happened, right? Basically producer only use if to check, oh, is this buffer is full? If buffer is full, wait for buffer to be empty. Then after consumer consume data, wake up the producer, then we produce data, then wake up one consumer to consume data, okay? Similarly for the consumer, we also check if the buffer is empty, consumer cannot continue, consumer wait, okay, until producer say, oh, we already generate data. Producer is here, right? You can see producer send a signal. After producer generate data, producer will send a signal, right? So wake up the consumer, then get the data, then send a signal to wake up producer, right? Producer is waiting for here, right? So basically that's how it works. But yesterday, I really like this example. Yesterday we talked about this example, right? So we can see that if we have two consumer threads, one producer, right? In the beginning, consumer one running C1, C2, C3 here, because buffer is empty. So C1 sleep, right? Then C2 is ready to run, but C2 is not scheduled. Then we schedule P1 to run. Then P1 check, see, oh, this buffer is empty, so we can continue. So generate the data, change the state, right? Then continue, right? Then second iteration, after we check the state, oh, buffer now is full. So producer start to sleep. Particularly at this moment, after we generate the data, we signal, right? Wake up one thread. Then because consumer one is waiting for the buffer to be filled. So you can see after we send this signal, then consumer one is waked up. So consumer one is ready to run. So nothing wrong at this moment. Everything is perfect, okay? However, at this moment, scheduler schedule consumer two to run. Consumer two just to check the state, see, oh, now we have data, right? Then consume it. Make the state become zero. Then grab data and wake up. Here, wake up, right? Wake up the producer, right? So you can see producer become ready at this moment after consumer two wake up, right? Then after that, basically, we have a context switch, okay? At this moment, we switch to consumer one. Then remember, consumer one is asleep, then acquire the log, then now it can directly consume data. However, you can see counter right now is zero, which means the buffer is empty, right? So before, at this moment, when we wake up consumer one, at that moment, you can see the buffer is full, right? However, when consumer one really is scheduled to run, at this moment, the state has been changed. However, consumer one has no idea. Consumer one will continue to consume data, even the buffer is empty. So we have error. Is this clear? Any questions for this one? Yeah, yesterday I'm very fast, but I just want to give you a general idea. So today I want to really let you understand this part. So any questions at this moment? Hello guys, can you hear me? Maybe it's too late to ask this. Yeah. So you can hear me, right? But you don't know what I'm talking about. You can hear me, but you hear nothing, right? Too late, huh? Okay. Yeah. So any questions for this part? Huh? It's too hard to answer. Okay, so remember now we have multiple threads, right? So that's the issue, right? So but generally speaking, you should go back to look at you should go back to look at the code, right? Look at the code. We have producer, we have consumer, okay? I will also provide some example. You can run those programs. Then you can really see we have a multiple thread. Then you can understand it, okay? So don't worry. So multiple thread is a little bit difficult, but generally speaking, you can think about we have some shared. So shared variable. Right now we have a buffer. This is a global buffer shared between producer and consumer. We have one thread called producer. Just try to generate the data put into the buffer. All right. Then we have another thread called consumer. Always want to get data from the buffer, right? So for this variable, buffer variable, we have a state, which is, we use count to represent. Either is zero, which means, oh, this is empty. Oh, this count is one, this is full. Basically, that's what we are doing right now. Then we talk about how to use the conditional variable to coordinate producer and consumer to fill up the buffer and consume properly, right? So basically, you can I think this deserves a little bit more kind of understanding. You need to spend a little bit more time to go through this code and also really run the program. Then you can understand. I will provide some program over there. Then you can run it. Yeah. So is there any specific question? C2, C3 is atomic. Can interrupt happen between them? Of course. C2, C3 are not atomic, right? We can only guarantee one particular instruction is atomic. So can you guys tell me which one is atomic? C1 or C2, Hello? C1, right? C1, this is we talk about, we spend some time to talk about how to design a log to make it become atomic, right? Basically, when we do this operation, when we do log, this is atomic. However, all other instruction, all other statement are not atomic. An interrupt can happen in between. Yeah. But this here only show one situation. In this situation, actually, you can see consumer one, consumer data, even the buffer is empty. This is not correct because when the buffer is empty, then we should not continuously consume data. Then how to solve this? Then what is the fundamental issue? Okay, look at this slide. So why this happened? The reason is that you can see after producer wake up TC1, but before TC1 really run, the state of a bound buffer has been changed by TC2, right? So is this exactly, you can see here, look at here. At this moment, producer say, okay, now wake up, TC1 wake up, right? So at this moment, actually our buffer state is full, is correct. If we can directly run TC1, then we are okay. We can consume data, right? However, in between, we cannot guarantee TC1 can run. Basically, we schedule TC2 to run, right? So TC2 consume data. Then we run TC1. When we run TC1, actually, the state has been changed. Okay, but at this moment, we already checked the state. We make sure, this state is correct, then you should consume data. That's wrong. Okay, so this is why you can see that no guarantee when the vacant thread run, the state will still be as desired. This is a very good example. You can see here, when we run, when TC1 really get chance to run, the state has been changed. So this is most often happened cases, okay? And also we need to guarantee our program can run properly with this kind of situation. So every system will assume MESA semantics. This we call MESA semantics. That means when vacant thread run, the state cannot be guaranteed as desired. State can be changed, okay, basically. Another is Hauer semantics that provide a stronger guarantee. Basically, the vacant thread will run immediately, but this is not impractical. In practice, actually, we will assume MESA semantics. Basically, the state will be changed, can be changed when we really run a vacant thread. So to solve this, it's very simple. That means, okay, even we wake up a particular thread, then we cannot guarantee the state has been changed or not. So to solve this issue, then it's very simple. We just use while. You can see if we check this, then wait, right? Then another thread wake up the waiting thread based on the condition. However, when we really call this thread to run, that condition, the state may be changed. Okay, so we need to recheck. So use while, okay, rather than if. Is this clear? So if we use while, it's okay. Because under this situation, when we use while, then we will go back to check that condition, right? Then basically we will go back to C2. If we use while, after we wake up, we will go back to check this condition. Then we cannot continue, right? We will continue to sleep if this condition has, if the counter is zero, which means, okay, buffer is empty already, then we just wait, we just sleep, right? Okay, so we can solve the issue. So basically, this is why when we consume, when TC1 wakes up, then we should recheck the state. Then how to do it? Then just change if to while. Okay, then you can see that this is why whenever we use conditional variable, always use while when we check the state. Okay, that's our rule one, okay, the first rule. Okay, a simple rule to remember with conditional variable is to always use while loop. Okay, just use while loop is good enough. Okay. However, this part of the code cannot work. Still cannot work. Okay. Still cannot work. Okay. So yeah. Yeah. So I think yes, maybe you guys interrupt is okay, right? Interrupt. After we have interrupt, after we check it, so basically, so you can you think about. I think one student asked, see that interrupt can still occur, right? Even we change it to the well, but it's okay. As long as we change it to well, you can see here. After we wake up, we'll go back to execute C2 again, right? Then we check the counter. This state, we check this, okay. If this become zero, then we will go back to the state, okay. It should be okay, right? Okay, let me continue, okay, to look at. After we change it to well, let's see, this is our code now. You can see we have a well here, we change it to well, right? Then we have P1, P2, P3. P1 is acquire the log. P2 is check the state. P3 is wait, and so on. Then P4 is waked up to generate data. Then P5 is send signal, right? Similarly, for the consumer, C1 is acquire the log. C2 is check the variable state. Check the state, buffer state. Then C3 is wait. If the buffer is empty, wait on this conditional variable. Then C4 is waked up by the producer, then consume data, then send a signal. Send a signal to the producer, right? To wake up the thread waiting for this condition, okay? Basically, this is our program over there. So let's look at why this program still cannot work properly. Similarly, we have two consumers, one producer. Okay, in the beginning, we schedule consumer one to run, C1 run, consumer one run the first state, basically acquire the log, because the log is not acquired by anyone. So C1 acquire the log, C2 check the state, right? State here, count zero. Our buffer is empty. Okay, so C3 sleep, waiting for this state is changed. Okay, so wait on the queue in for the conditional variable. Okay, then our scheduler somehow schedule consumer two to run. Okay, then we run C1. Right, C1 acquires the log because consumer one before sleep release the log. Okay, so consumer two can acquire the log, enter into the critical section, then consumer two checks the state. Because now the state is zero, count is zero, which means the buffer is empty. So consumer two at state three will go to sleep, waiting for the buffer to be filled. Okay, then continue. Producer now is scheduled to run. So producer acquires a log. Okay. Similarly, because the log has been released by consumer two, producer can acquire the log, then enter into the critical section. Okay. Then after we acquire this one, then we go to the P2, second state. Second state is check the counter. So counter is zero, right? That's good, right? Because the producer want to see whether or not the buffer is empty. So counter is zero means buffer is empty. So we skip the P3. P3, state three actually is wait. If count is one, which means buffer is full, then we should sleep, right? So now buffer is not, let me show you the code that you know. See, basically you can see here, right? C2, is not here, it's this one, right? P2, right? So if count will count equals one, then we will wait, right? Count right now is zero, so we go to the P4, generate the data, put I, right? So you can see here, we put I, then also change the state, right? So buffer is full now. Then P5 is wake up the thread waiting for, right? So we will wake up one of them. Somehow we wake up consumer one. You can see consumer one now is ready to run, okay? Then we continue, release the log. Then next iteration, acquire the log. Acquire the log, then go to check our count, the state. State now, right now become one, buffer is full. So at this moment, sleep, okay? Great, must sleep, right? Sleep, okay? So producer successfully generated the data at this moment, then sleep, okay? Right now, consumer one is scheduled to run, right? So consumer one say, okay, great. Okay, finally, I got a chance to run. Hey, C3, why we go to C2? Something wrong here. We already finished C3, why we go back to C2? What is C3? What is C2? Let's see, okay. What is C3? C3 is well, C2 is well, right? C3 is wait, right? After we finish C3, we should go to C4, then how come we go back to C2? Something wrong here. Can you guys help me? Okay, I think some students already tell the answer, because it's well, right? We change the well, right? We change it to well. If it's if, then we go to the C4. However, this is well, then because it's a loop, right? After we wake up, we go back to check this again. So we go back to C2. Agree? Right? So I think some students are happy to answer this, okay? Thank you, guys. You guys are very smart, okay? Identify this one. So basically, you can see here, because the well, we go back to check this condition again, okay? We check the condition, this count is one, great, okay? That's great. We check the condition, that's great, okay? Then we go to the C4. count is one. If count is zero, then we go to sleep. Count is four, then we consume data. Then consumer one grab the data, right? Get the data, right? Then wake up, okay? It need to wake up producer, right? It need to wake up producer. However, how come we took producer is not waked up? Producer is in the sleep, still in sleep. Something wrong here, right? Yeah, we cannot guarantee when we wake up. We can only wake up one thread waiting for this condition variable, right? So both consumer two and the producer are waiting on the queue of this conditional variable. So somehow, okay, consumer two is waked up, okay? Not producer, okay? So this is why we call it the risk condition, right? So in some case, maybe producer will be wake up. Then in that case, actually our program will work properly. However, if consumer two is waked up, in some cases, then you can see our situation is that continue, right? So for example, we finish this one, then we go to the C6, release the log, then acquire the log again, then check the condition, count is zero, right? So we sleep. We sleep here, right? Then we switch back to run consumer two, because consumer two is waking up, right? Consumer two also check this condition, right? Consumer two say, okay, because the buffer is empty, so I have to sleep, okay? I also sleep, okay? So yeah, everyone is asleep. Then everyone is asleep. Then basically, no one can be waked up. So our program cannot move forward. Okay, we cannot continuously consume and produce data, right? So is this clear? For this situation, is it clear? So the situation here, in summary, is that consumers should not wake other consumers. It only can consume, can wake up producer, right? Vice versa, which means producer can only wake up consumer, not producer, right? But if we don't identify consumer and the producer, then we cannot do this. If we have a conditional variable, then both producer and the consumer wait for the conditional variable to be changed, then wait for the state to be changed and wait for the signal, then basically we cannot identify. Then the solution is, so what is the solution? Think about that. So how to basically distinguish producer and consumer, right? So that's the question, right? So I noticed there are some questions here. Yes, the solution is to use two variables. Yeah, you guys are very smart. Okay, basically, in order to distinguish producer and consumer, right? So we should have two conditional variables. So producer should wait on condition empty. If the buffer is full, right? If the buffer is full, then basically, you can see. I think the user code is better. You can see here. See, this is our producer, right? If our state buffer is full, right? Then producer need to wait until buffer is empty. Wait. So here the description is wait on the conditional variable, but the idea here inside is that if the buffer is full, we need to wait until our buffer become empty, right? Right, so this is the why the explanation here is that P producer should wait on the condition empty. So basically, our code is like this. You can see here, if buffer is full, the state count is equal to one, then we should wait until the buffer is empty. Okay, then after wake up, then we should generate data. Then after that, we should send a signal to this condition fail, which means, okay, the buffer now is full for any consumer that is waiting for the buffer to be filled. Now, one consumer can be waked up. Similarly, consumer should wait for if the buffer, you can see consumer here. If buffer is empty, consumer should wait until the buffer is filled, right? Consumer wait for buffer to be filled. Then after consumer is waked up, then we can consume data, then send signal to one producer waiting for buffer to be empty. Okay, so we send signal to empty. Basically, we are okay now. Okay, so that's a solution for this question. Okay, I think one student asked one question, say that the question is that when we go to C1, C2, right? Here, for example, we go to C1, then we go to C2, we go to C3, except C1 is atomic operations, C2, C3, all other are not atomic operations. Then how can we guarantee this can be executed properly, right? So what do you think? So the question is that C1 is the atomic operation, right? C2, C3, and all other statements are not atomic. Then how can we guarantee this can be executed properly? Exactly. I think one student answered they say that we have lock, right? So think about that. That's exactly why we want to have a lock, right? So if we acquire the lock, then no matter what, okay, you can, if for example, consumer one acquires the lock, then if interrupt occurred and schedule the other thread to run, it's okay. Because other thread can, if other thread want to enter the critical section, other thread need to acquire the lock, right? Then because the lock is held by consumer one, then other thread will wait for the lock to be released. Then basically we can guarantee the mutual exclusive access in this critical section, right? Right, so that's exactly what we want to have. So I think that's a very good question, but basically when we solve this, we solved with our lock, right? So we use lock here. So this is why we want to start with lock, right? When we enter critical section, we use lock. Then if we acquire lock, then no other thread can enter into this critical section. For example, if a consumer already acquire this log, then basically no other code can run this part, right? All other code will, for example, producer, when acquire the log, producer will wait for the log. Then similarly, for the consumer, another consumer, if we try to acquire the log, another consumer will wait for the log, right? So then in this way, we can guarantee mutually exclusive. Okay, I guess that's basic idea, right, about this part. But to generalize, in the textbook, we can make our buffer become a array. Okay, we can add more buffer slot, for example, right? So then in this way, we can have more concurrency and efficiency. Then you can see here, then we put a buffer array with a maximum capacity. Then we have a fill, use, count. Now basically our put and get function need to be changed a little bit. The idea here that use the fill and use to remember the position for the producer and consumer. So basically, producer and consumer need to know which one to consume or which one to produce. That's it. Okay. Then you can see that after we produce the data, we change the next location. Next location for producer to produce data, right? So basically here, we have to consider our bounded buffer. This, because it's the bounded buffer from zero to max minus one, okay? Then this is why after we get the next position, for example, we already are here, right? Then we should, at this moment, we are here, right? Then suppose when we use producer at this moment, this position is maximum minus one, okay? So next position is what? Max minus one plus one, right? You can see plus one. So it become max, then modular max, then we go back to here. So basically we want to make sure that we are bounded by this buffer, okay? From zero to max minus one. Similarly, also is we can use the use to record the next location for consumer to consume data. Okay, generally speaking, that's what we have. Our condition become counter. So our condition still is a counter, to use counter to represent. However, maximum value become max, right? The minimum value is zero still. So for producer, if count become max, which means, oh, we already make this buffer full, then basically we need to wait. Then similarly for the consumer is a similar, right? If it's a zero, then we wait. Something like that, okay. So we don't have time, but I think this part, I just want to mention, okay, I will not talk about this part anymore. But generally speaking, when we have this kind of situation, for example, if one thread free a space with 50 bytes, however, we have two thread waiting for this space. One is waiting for 100, another one is waiting for 10. So under current situation, because when we wake up, we don't know which one to be waked up, okay? So if we have both A and B, then certainly we may either wake up A or B, okay? If we wake up A, actually it cannot help because A need 100 bytes. However, we only free 50, right? So how to handle this kind of situation? So a lot of thread waiting for a particular state to be changed. However, we need more information after state change, right? So basically, this is the why you can see we have another signal approach called broadcast. The idea that under this situation, wake up all waiting thread, then each thread will check the condition Then if the condition is not satisfied, go back to sleep. Of course, the cost is too many threat, right, to be wake up. But that can solve this issue. Right? So with that, I want to conclude this part. Basically, we talk about the log, we talk about conditional variable. Okay. Next week, I want to talk about semaphore. Of course, I will give you some example related to conditional variable and so on. Yeah, I will release those program after the lecture. Okay. So that's all for today's lecture. I'm ready to answer some question. So if you want to attend the QA session, then please stay here and input your question through the chat box. Otherwise, you can leave now. Yeah, let me copy some questions. See what kind of question you have. Okay. I think one question is the C2, C3 are atomic or not? Not, right. However, C1 is a log, right? It's atomic. So we can guarantee the mutual exclusive. For the critical session is locked, right? It doesn't matter. We may have interrupt, so it doesn't matter, right? Yeah, I think this is a associated question, but we can still get the interrupt after check, right? But it's okay, right? It's okay. The critical section has to be protected by the log, right? Yeah, so I think some students help me to answer that question well, right? Yeah, well is good, okay? Loop is good. Yeah. Yes, everybody sleep, yeah. So only 1 week left, right? Yes. The question is only 1 week left. I think this is not a question, right? Yeah. Yes. Only 1 week. Yeah. So I know you may want to ask about the final exam, right? So I will talk about final exam in next week, right? In the final lecture, maybe have 15 minutes, okay? Don't expect too much for my 15 minutes. But basically, if you can do the homework, then you should be okay for the final exam, right? Okay, so let me see other questions. What is that? Yeah. Okay, let me copy more questions. Hopefully I can copy. Okay, only 1 week left. Must thread use the same conditional variable in the I don't know the what is the question here. I'm not sure the question. I need more information about the question. Are the threads use the same condition variable in the same waiting queue when sleep? So maybe the question is related to like we have two condition variable right now, right? Then you can see that producer will wait on empty, right? The consumer will wait on fill. So they will, yeah, maybe I think your question is that if I have multiple consumer, right? Multiple consumer thread, then should they use the same conditional variable to wait? What do you think? Of course, we will use the same conditional variable. Otherwise, we cannot guarantee, right? Same conditional variable, right? I hope I answer your question, right? Similarly, for the, for the either is a producer or consumer, right? We should use the, they will use the same condition variable, right? One condition variable then one Q. Yes, okay. One condition variable is one Q. You can think about like that. Yeah. So can you explain the cover condition again? Okay, I will talk about that later. Okay. Yeah, for the exam, right? Yeah, I will talk about exam next week. Yeah, I think I already mentioned, right? Final exam is open book. Yesterday I talked about, right? Open book. I already updated that slide related to the assessment. You can see the final exam is the open book. So I will send an announcement related to the final exam. But the final exam is open book, yes. Is open book, okay? In terms of internet, okay, yeah, I'm still thinking about this. For internet, okay. Maybe it will allow you to do it, right? So because it's very hard for us to to disallow you. We cannot guarantee that, right? So basically we allow you to access internet. Yes. Okay, but I will talk about that later, okay? So don't worry about the final exam, okay? I will talk about it later, right? Yeah, because basically I cannot guarantee, how can I disallow you to use the internet if we have online exam? I think one student mentioned that if we don't use internet, we cannot even browse the blackboard and so on, right? So you are right, okay? Yeah, we will allow you to do that. Certainly we can do a lot of things, but I think I just want to make sure that to be fair to everyone, then basically we can allow you to answer. It's okay, we can generate some questions that you cannot find the answer from the internet. Should be okay. Okay, let me explain the cover. I think one student want me to explain the cover conditions, right? So let me explain that again. So cover condition, right? So can you guys see the slides here? Hello? Do I have student waiting for this part? Oh, I'm the only one to talk this topic here. We still have several students. Okay, great. So you guys can see it, right? So the cover condition is like this. Suppose two threads, A and B, both waiting for some space because we don't have space. Then thread C release a space. However, the space is 50 bytes, right? Okay. Yeah, so you can see the code is like this, right? When we allocate, if we don't have enough size, then we just wait. You can see here, right? Otherwise we can continue, right? So for the free, basically, you can see here, we just say, oh, we have enough space. We have released some space, then go back to wake up some thread that is waiting for the space. Right? However, when we do this signal, remember, we cannot specifically wake up a particular thread. So this function can only wake up one thread, but we don't know which thread to be wake up. Yeah, so go back to this question. You look at here. Suppose we wake up this thread. Actually, this thread will check the condition, right? Then go back to sleep again. Okay, however, we already, the producer already generated data. Producer already finished, right? So then we cannot satisfy one thread requirement, even we have space, right? So that's the issue. Do you understand the issue right now? I think the issue, the question must be clear. See, we can wake up. Producer generates some space, right? Free 15. However, wake up thread A. Thread A need 100 bytes. Thread A go back to sleep again. However, we can, if we can wake up thread B, then thread B can continue because thread B waiting for like 10 bytes. We already free 50 bytes, right? So under this situation, under current situation, our signal can only wake up one thread. We cannot guarantee which thread to be waked up. We cannot specify which thread to be waked up. So that's the issue. So this is the one. Under this condition, we should replace signal with broadcast. Okay, broadcast means what? Broadcast means, look at this conditional variable. For all thread waiting on the queue, we wake up all of them. Okay, so everyone will run it. Okay. Then this is okay. You can see this code is still okay. If we change to broadcast here, it's okay. Broadcast is here. Broadcast is a signal, right? We change signal become broadcast. So waiting is still wait on this condition. Then broadcast means all thread waiting for this condition, all thread, right? For example, A and B, both waiting on this queue. A and B, both will be waked up. Then each of them will check this condition. Then B will continue to get this side and so on. However, on the other hand, A will say, okay, so I don't have enough space. There's no enough free space. So basically A will go back to sleep, right? So you can see here, right? When we free 15, B is okay. Then B can continue. A will go back to sleep. So that's the idea. Basically we can use this one. Then those thread cannot get the desired space, then go back to sleep, then we are okay. So otherwise in this situation is kind of like, we already have enough space. However, maybe one thread is always waiting for that space, right? Basically that's what we call. We use the broadcast to satisfy this kind of situation, to cover, we call it covered conditions. I hope I explain this clear. I have another lesson. I have to go see you and Okay. Okay. Yes. Yes. Thank you. Okay. But anyway, I explain this here, then I hopefully you can come back to watch the video. Okay. So any other questions? Hello guys, any other questions? Okay, no more question. Okay, so don't forget today's tutorial, which is very important, help you to understand the part. Okay, I will see you next week. Bye-bye.